I have the agenda.
Here, just put another ring.
You're opening, right?
Did you get that email?
Okay, call to order, presentation of sewer rate study by Mr. Cricket.
Thank you. James, do you want to hand out a copy of that presentation to everybody so they can take notes? Again, I'm Dave Cricket with DPC Engineering. Tonight, we're going to have our first, I'll call it a workshop, with the newly formed committee and representatives of town staff. I think what we'll try to do this evening, again, you've had the draft report, not a lot of time to read it, but if we could try to get through a 15 to 20 minute presentation followed by the question and answer, I think that that might be the most efficient way to handle things, but I am your servant, so if you guys feel like you need to jump in and ask questions, then I'll leave that up to you to determine. So James Rivers also worked on the project, is with me this evening. Again, after the presentation, we'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have. I'll start this by saying this evening that I think the expectation is not that we would get through all this evening. I think this is the first in a series of discussions. You obviously need enough time to acclimate to the details, and we've had the fortune of working on this for the past 3 to 4 months. So, you know, obviously, you guys need an opportunity to dive into the details as well. So we'll get started. This evening, we're going to cover several topics. We tried to keep the presentation kind of as high level, satellite type view at first, and then we'll drill down into the details as necessary. But we'll go through some terminology that may or may not be familiar to you relative to water and sewer rate systems and billing codes, etc. We'll talk about the project goals. Those are important. We're obviously talking about something that may or may not be near and dear to your heart, whether you're on sewer or not. So the financial discussions that come up in these projects are, you know, often they hit home relative to whether you're on the sewer or not and what you may or may not be paying for. So we try to provide things to, you know, to be as fair and equitable as possible. We'll talk a little bit about your current sewer rate system. And then we'll talk about, you know, how you stack up big picture against other similar communities. And those communities that we may not have seen that are familiar, we can add those to the list so you can kind of understand before you embark down this path, where do you stack up against other communities in the state? I think it's important to kind of understand. We'll talk about budget projections, and that is probably the element of the project that's most important relative to your input. Some things like O&M have been on for a long time, and you know there's a science to it. But when it comes to talking about future capital and debt service, those of you that come from a financial or public service background, you understand the impact that those debt services can have on budgets. So that'll be very important to get the committee's input there. We'll also talk about alternative rates, how you might collect revenues in other manners to offset your expenses. And lastly, we'll talk about our preliminary recommendations. Again, those are based on revenues that that need to be met to achieve your expense projections. And if our expense projections are adjusted, the revenues would be adjusted accordingly. So terminology. There are generally three types of rate structures that exist for sewer utilities. The first is a fixed fee structure. A fixed fee is basically a price that each sewer customer would pay regardless of how much water they use. So you could have a couple that may be retired that go to Florida for 6 months in the winter and come back. They would pay the same as the family of six that do 12 loads of laundry a week. That is by definition fixed fee. Same dollars for all folks or customers that are in the same class, i.e. residential, for a given year. The second type of sewer rate structure is a fixed rate. That is essentially saying you're going to pay the utility a fixed dollars per gallon or 100 cubic feet or 1,000 gallons for every drop of water that you use. for those of you that have had a chance to read through the memo, you are in a fixed rate system right now. That is how Deerfield has been operating. The third one is an ascending rate, and this is, I would say, gaining popularity statewide over the last 10 years. It's also a rate system based on dollars per gallon, but it would, I guess you'd say, reward those who use less water. So those folks that may choose to have discretionary use like lawn watering, et cetera, when they got over a certain threshold of gallons per year, they would pay a higher dollar per gallon bracket as things go up. I can't think of any communities directly around us that use that, but in those communities out east that suffer from water shortages out in the Milford Franklin area, those types of rates had gained popularity in the last 10 to 15 years. On the billing side, we have a term base charge. Base charge would be the minimum amount charged. That's essentially a fee or rate that's added to the base charge. Minimum charge, on the other hand, is if your sewer usage were so low that you were below a threshold. Right now, I think it's $65 per billing period is the 40 plus the 25. If you used so little water that you were under that threshold, you would just pay the minimum fee. You know, base charge comes into, a hybrid system where maybe some of my costs, like debt service, are fixed, and every customer is going to pay that same allocation for that debt service, and then the user fee would cover the amount of water that's used above and beyond that. So that comes into some of the hybrid options we look at. Abatement, you currently do have an abatement program. An abatement would be a discount that's offered to a sewer customer for... again, in your case, I think the most appropriate analogy is those that may use a lot more water for the summer billing period versus the winter are eligible for an abatement or a discount on their bill. Project goals, just in summary of the data, it's a pretty big effort to put, that's the biggest part of the project by far, is getting the data from the sewer user charge system for the last 3 years, getting the assessor's data, merging all of that data into a single database, where you're talking about six billing periods, it's fairly cumbersome. But that's the data we chose to work with. So just so everyone understands, it's those three calendar years. And I mentioned, and I touched a little bit about the key project goal, fair and equitable. I keep coming back to that because I'm sure that we'll have discussions about rates, structures that may appeal to us as a group, but we need to make sure that whatever the collective recommendation, that it's fair and equitable for the community as a whole. Even if there are a few outliers, there will always be people on both ends of the spectrum for any alternative. And when we talk about our budget projection, we're talking about four elements that comprise the budget, and we'll come back to this later in the presentation, but O&M, and Keith can certainly attest to that. There's a track record of every year you would develop your budget with Kevin, and that would cover your operating expenses. The second is debt service. Now, Deerfield doesn't have any current debt service for wastewater. That's great, but that's generally an indication that an asset or a renewal of an asset has been deferred. So I think we could probably all agree to one extent or another that Deerfield's wastewater infrastructure, sewers treatment plant are mature. We could just leave it at that. So it's an appropriate time to talk about capital. Future debt service, very clear. That would be what would come in the future. And that's, again, that's where we have the most discretion to develop a plan. And lastly is reserve fund. This is one that in New England with infrastructure usually goes by the wayside. But, rule of thumb is you try to have about 1 year's operating budget in reserve at any given time. Now, I would probably be willing to venture that less than a quarter of the wastewater utilities in the Commonwealth have a reserve budget in excess of 1 year's. Particularly for smaller communities, it's very challenging. 90 days is a bare minimum, and you might ask, why would you want to have a reserve? Well, Keith, if you had a clarifier mechanism fall into your tank, I'm sure you could appreciate the magnitude of what it would cost to get that replaced and or repaired on an emergency basis. So public infrastructure, emergency repairs, buying equipment, going through $100,000 to $200,000 for some type of an emergency, it seems like a lot of money, but it would happen in a hurry. So that's definitely something we'll need to discuss. Current rate system. Again, you're in that fixed rate based entirely on usage, and you pay on a dollars per thousand gallons. That's the metric that you use to assess all your sewer customers' bills. You have 882 sewer customers. James hasn't quite memorized all of them, but about 70% probably. And then you have 7 unbilled customers. We'll come back to those because that's an interesting category of potential revenue that should be explored. Your billing structure right now, for fiscal 16, your billing rate was $6.74 per 1,000 gallons. I don't believe that has changed for fiscal 17 yet. I think that's still status quo.
That's correct.
So that's where we're at. Again, your minimum fee of $40 per billing period per customer, and your sewer connection fee of $25 per billing period per customer. Based on the usage that all your residential customers had for those 3 years from 13 to 15, your average bill based on your current rates, $428 per residential customer. And then you have the summer usage abatement option. If your summer usage is 125% more than winter, that's almost going to be the case for everybody. I'm not sure how many people technically qualify, but that's a slippery slope with abatements, and it's okay to have abatements, but we have to hedge our risk by planning for, say, if it's a 5-10% potential loss in revenue, we have to plan for that on the other side with the rates. So benchmarking. We talked a little bit about where you're at right now. In 2014, and these are numbers that come from Ty and Bond every other year, does a water and sewer rate analysis. Mass and Connecticut, they flip-flop each year. But 2014, they did one for Mass. The statewide average was $756 per residential home. The state median was $729. So there's pretty good correlation between those two. Again, these are based on statewide surveys that are done. I can tell you that it says in there that the average increase per year per wastewater utility over the last 10 years is 10% a year. So wastewater costs have definitely outpaced inflation, and I think some of that is driven by the new permit requirements that are put on a lot of the communities. A lot of the treatment plants in the state now have to remove phosphorus or now have to remove nitrogen. And then when they go past the phosphorus, they'll say, well, that was great. Now I want you to take out copper and all the metals and everything else that are leaching out of the water pipes. So we're on that kind of vertical scale. It's a challenging place to be for a utility, but that's just the reality. And some of the comps, at least in my eyes that I look at, you know, Deerfield is a unique community. You kind of have those folks that have been here, but you have that commercial element, you have that tourist element. I compared a couple, Sturbridge and Lennox jumped out at us, having worked in both communities, kind of similar in that they have the tourist attractions, they have the residential base, but they also have a good non-residential commercial base too. Sturbridge has been through a major capital upgrade over the last 10 years, new treatment plant, adding a whole bunch of sewer customers. I can tell you that the plant debt went on the sewer customers, but the homeowners paid 100% of the cost for their betterments for the sewer extensions. So someone brought up a question, and it may have been in your email that was sent around, is which communities include the debt service on the user fee versus on the general fund? And it's most of the time, I'll say the majority, it's in the user fees. But there are some communities which are essentially fully sewered that say it doesn't really matter whether it's on the user fees or the general fund if everybody's sewered. But in the case of Deerfield, where that's not the case, it does matter. Because those folks that are not on the sewer obviously would probably prefer not to pay for the debt service for those that are. So our job is to... Well, there you go. I'm not a lawyer, but I can slice and dice. We can slice and dice however we need to show you here's how you can collect revenue. But it's up to you collectively to come up with your budgets and be comfortable with those. The dollars you need to bring in, that's just balancing the budget. So just taking a look at some of the past budgets, where we're at and where we think things were going based on, we had Kevin, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 kind of informal type workshops with you and Doug and Tony DeSimone, Weston and Sampson, and us to just try to get a handle on where things are going. Obviously, plant upgrades aren't anything new to the world, so there's pretty good precedence relative to dollars per gallon, et cetera. But, you know, last year, fiscal year 16, you were at a budget of 530-ish, roughly,
yep.
$530,000. You have a new budget for fiscal 17 of about 6.25, rough numbers. Your current budget starts to address, I would say, some of your appropriately or adequately funded O&M needs. You know, Kevin, feel free to jump in and slap me back in a line if I need to be. But you can see that at some point you're going to go vertical as you move to the right. Your debt service, whether it be for 1 or 2 plant upgrades and or, you know, some type of consolidation from 2 plants down to 1, it's going to be a major capital expense. You have a relatively low number of connections and customers. The debt service just gets extrapolated on those. I think the key that we'll talk about moving forward is getting grants for projects. I mean, if we can find grants, that immediately takes it down. So round numbers, just to pause here for a second. For every $1 million financed, if we finance that, I say we collectively, the town, if that's we're financed on a typical bond at 2.5% roughly, and based on my understanding of your, you know, your track record, you guys would be in the high category for bonding. $60,000 per year is your payment back on $1 million of debt under conventional financing. You have programs like USDA Rural Development, which I believe Deerfield has worked with in the past, at least has explored that as an option. That program allows up to a 40-year loan, again, at a very low interest rate. Now, we all know the mortgage game. You defer it out a longer period of time, you pay more money. But you cut your annual payment from $60,000 to $40,000 when you go through USDA. And if you can get, say, a 25% grant to make the math easy, because I'm not great at math, you take your $40,000 down to $30,000 a year. So when you're talking about $1 million financed, getting grants, getting low interest loans is critical. Right there, you went from $60,000 per year for a payment down to $30,000. But again, when you do the math, you're anticipating you're likely going to have a multi-million-dollar capital project in the next 10 years. So you do the math. Right now, you're at $624,000 per year is your budget. Say it's $5 million. You get $150,000 a year to add to that budget to pay your debt service, best case. And grants are getting more challenging to come by. We're working on some opportunities right now. But that just kind of frames the discussion as we move forward. And this seems like a group that does math in their head better than me anyway, so you may already be getting to that point. Summary of alternatives. You can carve this up, as I said, just about any way you want. Now that we've developed the model, we're happy to help you come up with new alternatives that we collectively hadn't thought of. But you have your current system. Your current system has been effective. I think there are some minor things that could be changed to improve it, but that's one alternative. You have your current rate system. You have alternative rate systems where you could adjust your minimum fees based on your current system. A copy of the handout. And then you have alternative rate structures where you could go to a straight fixed fee. I think in Deerfield, you have a widely varying sewer usage in your residential customers. I mean, you literally have some people that must very frugally use their water or be gone for long periods during the year. And you have others that use a tremendous amount of water. If you were to go to a fixed fee system where everyone would pay the same cost as residential customers, I think that would be a challenging transition, to say the least. Politically, that would be pretty tough. You have people, 20% of your customers on both ends of the spectrum. So you already have almost half your customers that would probably not be happy in one way or another. And then you have the hybrid type systems. Do we come up with an alternative where your fixed amount for every customer is based on your debt service? Because that's something that Deerfield needs to consider. Everyone who has a home has you know, kind of bought into having a treatment plan. If the treatment plan is upgraded, you each kind of have a pro rata share of that upgrade, whether you may be one person living in a home right now or a family of four, that could change tomorrow. And then the usage would go on top of that. So we're going to go through some of these alternatives, and there's a lot to absorb as we go through them, but we'll kind of circle back. So here we have, this is based on your fiscal year 17 budget. So this is based on your $624,000 budget, okay? You have four classes of sewer customers, which are shown down here. You have residential, commercial, industrial, and this other tax-exempt other. And then you have the rate alternatives. So in the purple, just for comparison, we compared the last full year of data we had was 2015. So we couldn't quite use 2016 because we only had half a year's data. But based on the 2015 consumption, which was actually lower townwide for residential sewer customers, you had a fee of annual cost of $418. So when you go through these other alternatives for the residential customers, alternative one is basically just the same as you have now, just I need my rate to be higher to go from what was a $530,000 budget to $624. It's a very linear connection. You have another alternative where the minimum fees associated with that alternative get raised. So those that use very little water would pay a slightly higher, can you bring one more copy back there? Would pay a slightly higher minimum fee. And then you have all the way out for this other alternative, which residential would stay the same, but commercial or non-residential users would pay. In this case, we just use a 15% higher rate. This is a question that gets asked in every rate study we do. Well, why don't the commercial users pay for the increases that are coming up? And that's challenging too. A lot of your commercial properties are probably the heavy taxpayers in town. So it's, you know, it's a finite balance, but we illustrate just what some of those dynamics do. And you can see that the residential rate drops back down a few bucks per household by putting that burden on the commercial properties. I would argue relative to fair and equitable, I don't think it's worth saving $20 or $30 per year per residential customer to put that burden on businesses in New England that, you know, are already often struggling with a fine line coming out of the last 10 years. So just again, my opinion. The next graphic.
Can you explain the tax exempt?
Yes, please.
The tax exempt?
Yeah.
So James, if you don't mind jumping in to just explain what types of properties are in that category. And
yeah, so when I came and looked at the assessor's data, you basically, the way it breaks down, you have your industrial properties, your commercial, your residential, and there was another category that falls in the assessor's data, such as Deerfield Academy, some of the town properties that are considered tax exempt or other properties. So they don't quite fit into your typical residential, commercial, or industrial property. So they're kind of a different class on their own. So we use them as another means of looking at the average numbers for the payout on each
they
sewer
still
user.
Pay fees to the sewer.
They still
yes.
do pay, yep.
Yes.
Yep, they are billed sewer users. Yep, oh yeah.
That does not include the seven.
No, none of this data includes the seven unbilled.
The seven, big seven.
Yeah.
The big seven, that's
exactly.
right.
Exactly.
Which is a small dollar amount.
So the next graphic, very similar to fiscal year 17. This is the projected budget for fiscal 18. Again, this is my interpretation of the projected budget based on discussions with the group. This is not a proposed budget that's been vetted publicly or, you know, from the department heads through the, you know, the select board yet. So this is just kind of a discussion point of how that curve may be ramping up. As I mentioned before, when you know you're headed down a path where your rates are or your costs are going to get significantly higher, you have two methods. You can either have step increases every year, every other year to get to that point, or you can have sharp increases that happen every 2 to 3 years or 3 to 4 years. Either is perfectly acceptable as long as there's a path to getting to that point. One thing we may or may not get into this evening relative to the details is some of those grant programs that we talked about actually use your current rates to determine your eligibility for grants. For example, one of the programs, USDA, as we talked about, will benchmark you and say, if your annual sewer bill isn't at least 1% of your median household income, then you're not considered maximum grant eligible. 2% is more desirable. RD does not scrutinize that you've planned 3 years in advance to put money in your retained earnings account in your enterprise fund. That is not a factor. It's based solely on the rates, how that compares to median household income and how that compares to the comps, the other communities that they look at. So, yeah, USDA, again, and they've been in to talk to the town. They typically look at your annual sewer cost. So right now the average is, what was it, 428 per year per residential home.
Is it average or medium?
It'll be the average cost per home compared to the median household income. They use the median household income. They use population. You're under 10,000, check. Median household income is defined, RD eligible. If you're less than 100% of the statewide non-metropolitan, so they take the cities out, median household income statewide, then you're eligible for grants. If you're under 80% of the median household income, which I believe Deerfield was, it was close, you're eligible for the Uber grant category, which has historically been 45% was the kind of maximum gold standard. I haven't had a lot of clients get 45% in the last 5 years. I think 20 to 30 is a more realistic expectation of premium grant eligibility in today's climate. Monroe did. That's one of my clients. Monroe is very unique. I think they have the highest rates in the state.
95 residents.
It's ad valorem. It's on their taxes. Monroe's in the process of doing a $3.6 million treatment plant upgrade, and I'd venture to say 200 or 300 taxable properties in the town. That might even be high.
90.
How many?
90.
90. Okay. So, you can quickly do the math there. They got a 75% grant from USDA. That commitment was made to Monroe, I believe, 4 or 5 years ago. So that is that was a unique situation for sure. Did I clarify the comment about the percentage?
Yes.
Of okay.
I just wanted to,
that's not a written guideline. That's kind of
a
Reader's Digest version of what we've been told they use for their underwriting process.
So is there any place we can find those rules and regulations relative to how a town qualifies for USDA?
Yeah, we certainly have. The town was provided copies by USDA. Mm-hmm. Len Shistak was in here, I don't know, 2-3 months ago, Kevin, something like that,
3 months ago.
To go over the program. Again, less than 10,000 population is the first column,
yep.
And then the median household income. I'll follow up with Doug on the what's your median household income from the 2010. It's based on the census, which is every 10 years. So
yeah,
that's the data that they're using right now. So you're in Len confirmed, you're in that maximum grant eligibility criteria. It's just a matter of what other requests are on the table at the year of the application relative to other funding applications and how they score you in the underwriting process. This changes every year. I mean, USDA is a federal program. It has political influence in it. The outcome of your request doesn't always match your expectation. I'll just leave it at that. Sometimes it can be a bit of a mystery, but when you're on the positive side of that mystery, you don't ask questions. You take it and you move on. So we're almost there. Your patience has been good, and then we'll get into Q&A. Preliminary recommendations. We believe, based on looking at your data, the spread of your data, talking to your team and your staff, that you would be best served by continuing to use your current fixed rate system. Obviously, you need to adjust your budget annually and consider where this is going relative to upgrade or upgrades of the system, and talk about whether you want to be in a step or a continuous manner, but you have a lot of decisions to make over the next 5 to 10 years. We do believe that you should increase your minimum fee, which is currently, it's technically $65 per billing period per customer. You have a 40 and a 25. We believe you should raise that to $100 per period per customer as a minimum fee. And boy, if it was up to us, we'd like to see you either get rid of your abatement program or to consider the magnitude of the potential abatement and adjust your rates accordingly. So if the sensitivity analysis is, and last year was 6%, about $35,000, we would want to see you take that 6% that could be negative in your revenues and add that to your rates the next year. So, you know, round numbers, if you needed to be at $7 per 1,000 gallons, you'd up that by 6% to make sure you cover your risk. You do not have a robust retained earnings account right now. I think it's $300,000-$400,000, something like that.
It's like $325,000.
It's not awful, but it's not, you know, it's not robust, and you do have some things that are permit and, you know, asset driven that you'll need to tackle that are above and beyond your O&M. So you'll probably dip into that in the next couple of years. And then for your non-billed sewer users, you know, those kind of schools, if you will, the Big Seven, or somebody mentioned over there, we'll come up with a good acronym for them. You had about $26,000-$27,000 in potential revenue last year. So if you decide that those customers are going to start being billed, which I don't understand the plus and minus with how it works with taxes and with schools and students from different communities, et cetera, but it's been my experience that anyone that's connected to sewer should be paying a sewer bill, period. Even if it's an internal transfer from one town department to another, that should happen. So you're in the process where Kevin and Doug will, you know, have to, you know, develop a fake bill if you decide to move forward with that, so that the school district or however these entities work can kind of plan for those costs for next year. And we're not too far off from that. I would think a lot of folks are going to start preparing their budgets October, November. So that's a decision that you should make in the next 2 months relative to that.
I think we already have. I don't know if they've actually been notified, but we've spoke about it, the Board of Selectmen.
Fantastic.
And that we're going to notify all town buildings that they're going to pay the same as you know, everybody else.
And okay. There's actually more than seven.
Is there? Okay.
Seven municipal buildings?
Municipal district buildings.
Okay.
There's a water district. There's also the two fire districts, two water districts. So there's four additional
okay.
that I've come up with just off the top of my head.
We went right after the Big Seven, and maybe we're too focused, but we could take a step back.
They're small users, but yeah, if we're going to bill everybody, we need to include it in their budget so that they can pay the town whatever the minimum fee, even if it's just the minimum fee.
So we're to the queue.
Agenda for next week to make sure that Doug wants to bill
them.
We're into Q&A. Mr. Chairman, if you want
to... No,
I don't know who's
It's related to this, though.
Okay.
What rate would the Big Seven be charged? A commercially, industrial, residential, or tax exempt?
Right now, it's all the same.
All the same rate. You take it over, Henry?
Oh, that's right. It's just the total dollars. Okay.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay.
So just to recap, I think I glossed over it on those graphics. There's a lot of colors popping there and everything. You're currently at $674 per thousand, and that's at your budget of $624,000. The projected budget we showed out there for fiscal year 18 was $757,000, and that was a rate of $9.74.
Question. When you did that, really, you haven't changed anything by just increasing the rate because the budget increased. There's no additional savings for stabilization or the reserve account in that rate?
Well, we did fund, well, the first 3 years, the contribution to reserves doesn't go up, but it does take, again, we have to revisit the assumptions. You know, if you say we want to have 90 days retained earnings at any given time, that's what we'll adjust the rate. If you say we want to have 2 years, then we'll adjust accordingly. The O&M goes up, I think we use 3-4% per year. That's relatively skinny, but a lot of that's driven by labor. You know, you've got the big four, the labor, power, sludge, chemicals, other. I mean, there's only four or five major categories. Kevin, I feel like you guys got a good handle on where that budget needs to be. And until you get a new permit that says now you need to remove more stuff from the water, you probably have a few years of stability where you can count on a fixed increase, you know, unless something weird happens with fuel prices or energy.
If I can, the only thing that's kind of a challenge for us at this point in time right now is our sludge that we get rid of. Historically, we used to bring that over to Montague. Well, presently right now, Montague is not accepting any sludge, and now we're having to ship it out of state. There's two places we could ahead ship it to. We could ship it to Cranston, Rhode Island, which is the present facility that we're bringing it to now, and correct me if I'm wrong. And Blackstone is the other place, but Blackstone will not accept what we have because there's too much
rag material, trash in it.
Where's Blackstone? Is that?
Upper Blackstone.
Milbury.
Am I thinking Milbury? Milbury, yeah, okay.
So.
What, now, how do we?
That's where Dennison's from.
Yeah, correct. Well, actually, that's the last place he worked.
Yeah.
And I just got word today from a driver, so it's not official by any means, but the drivers go to all these places and they share information that Upper Blackstone has more or less decided that they're not going to accept any sludge from any plant in Western Mass, period. 98% of us do not have headworks, so we all have trash in our sludge. And I think that's the imperative. That's the reasoning behind it.
So we're definitely approaching a sludge bubble, you know, the real estate bubble and the college loans, but.
What are we currently paid for a truckload, and what kind of, is it in a trailer dump or?
You have sludge hauling fees, you have the fees from the receiving end they charge, and then you have Franklin Regional Solid Waste Management takes a 3% flat fee for managing. So add all that together, and in the last, since May, the cost for hauling sludge per load has tripled.
How much is it?
Well, it's gone from, I believe, about $1,500 to about $3,700.
$3,700 per tank or load?
Per load.
Per load.
Yeah. Yep.
How often do you
and
do that?
And adjusts based on percent solids.
Yep.
So the thicker it is, the more it costs.
Oh, so
based
they weigh
on per dry ton of a load.
So how often do you do the?
Well, that changes too. That's a function of the flow and time of year and how much comes in, BOD-wise. There's all these variables. But on average, South Deerfield, you can count on 8 a month, and Old Deerfield, 2 to 3 a month. So
we're talking about
12,
around 10.
A dozen.
So 10 to 12 at $3,700.
Yeah.
Yeah.
$37,000.
$37,000 a
month. That's just to get rid of solids.
But it's my understanding that Montague might be back in the business in about 6 months.
And do we really want to put all our eggs back in that one basket again?
Well, we will once they be up and running.
Yeah, but they do shut down every May.
Also. I understand.
Yeah.
But it's not $3,700 a month.
Yeah, no, definitely not.
That's a unique situation over there, to say the least. Are you getting rid of liquid or cake?
No, liquid.
Liquid.
Yeah.
So obviously that would be one of the first things your committee would want to look through with your consultant on the facilities plan to see if you can improve from 3 to 4% solids. You know, that's 33% reduction in volume. So that's something that you could get to really quickly with some kind of plan to prioritize return on investment.
What are you talking about?
So if you're getting rid of a liquid at 3% and you can go up to 4%, you cut your effective trucking volume
down.
Well,
we can do that right now. We often do deliver a load of 4%.
Right.
We don't have that kind of granular control over the process.
Yeah.
But it's between 2.8 and 4.2 all the time.
Sure.
So that's the best we can do with that.
Yeah, well, anything over 4, they'd be complaining anyways. It'd be tough to move it.
But to get that, we also have to use a lot of polymer.
Yeah.
So there's another variable.
So
that's
Keith,
$8,000 a barrel.
If with the headworks project, how much will it reduce the weight of this, or how much sludge that we generate?
It won't.
Oh, it doesn't.
No.
Oh, okay.
Sludge is dead microbes. Microbes need to be wasted to control the balance between how many of them and how much food there is.
Okay.
But it will allow us.
To do with racks.
But it will allow it to be delivered to other
areas
in Massachusetts.
If you will, it's cleaner.
Cleaner.
Yeah. Exactly. Okay. It'll be rag-free. So that'll open up doors as far as... Then the only hurdle for Upper Blackstone would be percent solids, which is 4% or greater. Otherwise, you pay a premium on top. And I can't believe, really, they're becoming this restrictive in their own state, to their own state. They're forcing Western Mass to drive to another state to deliver their sludge, rather than take it on themselves. I mean, that seems a little...
It's getting worse, too, because they just changed the air permitting requirements, so a lot of the incinerators can no longer process. So, you know, it's kind of like the asphalt emulsion business after Katrina. You went from 3 suppliers to 1.
The same thing's going to happen.
Understood. No, I'm not being critical. It's going to get tighter, though.
It's the most ungreen.
Back here, you've had your hand up for quite a while.
We're looking for comparable communities why are you picking out villages like Sturbridge, which is one of the richest in the state, and Lennox, which is one of the richest, and North Brookfield? Why aren't you using rates like Greenfield and Northampton, Hatfield, close to us?
Yep.
Why aren't we using the ones close to us rather than trying to compare us to halfway to Boston or out to rich communities out in the western part of the state?
I certainly respect that comps are subjective, for sure. I think if I lined them up side by side, you'd find that the Deerfield and Sturbridge probably have a median household income within $5,000 of each other. You'd be surprised. Lennox is a little different. There's definitely a second home element there. But again, relative to size, the Northamptons and Greenfields and some of the larger utilities, they're tough comps. I work in Hatfield. I do their wastewater work. I can certainly, do you remember what Hatfield was off the top of your head? Your consumption's similar to Hatfield. Hatfield doesn't, they pay all their wastewater debt through the general fund too, though. So I'd have to adjust that one to show the parallel, where right now someone mentioned you have the regulation that requires your debt service to be on the sewer users. Hatfield's debt is on the general fund entirely.
Bruce?
Yeah, I would think that you'd want to do your comps on comparable users.
Yep.
Not by what we view, what by size of town or
sure.
annual median income. You'd want, because you have a plant, it takes so many dollars to operate a plant, and it depends on how many users split up that amount of money.
Yeah, we did our best based on population. The number of users isn't, that data is not readily available. We can go find it if you have specific communities in mind that you want us to use.
Hatfield will be one.
Yeah, we can show Hatfield. Again, I'll have to pull the general fund debt back onto the users, though, because it's not in there.
John?
Hatfield, they fund some of it through the general fund. Do they have 100% sewer users?
No.
No, Hatfield's.
Okay, is there
less
a different
than
rate?
50-50.
For the non-sewer users?
On the tax side?
No, on the.
On the use fee?
Yeah.
Only the users pay the user fee. Only those people connected to the sewer pay the user fee. So in Hatfield, the user fee pays O&M. In Hatfield, the general fund, the debt service is paid for through the general fund for all water, wastewater.
It doesn't matter. I'll say there's no break to the non-sewer
no.
users.
But the 50-50 thing's fairly common in the smaller towns, half sewered, half unsewered. And, you know, you're in that ballpark.
And Trevor?
Wasn't there an informal discussion about talking with you and the plant the other day about ways to deal with that waste and that sludge? Like, you had talked about planting.
About bringing a solids handling facility in Western Mass to Deerfield in particular. And what's your question?
So how do we get that?
How was Montague composting their sludge?
So they have a completely different system.
They weren't, yeah.
Is it that difficult, though, to mimic it?
So yes, Montague doesn't have a solid.
Yes, it is difficult to mimic it. Extremely difficult.
To the point that the people that were trained on how to do it, they sent them to
Germany?
They actually visited.
They learned it in Germany, and they came back, and they were trying to implement it.
But the comparison there is that Montague's plant, roughly, is 15 times bigger than they need for their own flow.
Yeah.
So they have, they run it like an aerobic digester. I mean, it's not a sep. They're really running their whole plant as a solids handling facility. It's it's very unique. It was very creative. It's a situation that puts the operators potentially in a perpetual state of my tachometer's at 7,000 RPM too. Living in the red like that, it's a fine line too. But there where you have 15 times factor of safety, who cares, right? The money was pouring in.
And it wasn't cheap to build it either.
No, a long time ago too.
How do we do what Montague did?
You
have to upgrade the plant. You have to upgrade the plant, Trevor.
What's your annual sludge budget, roughly?
My annual sludge budget, roughly. I think it's half a million, roughly.
Well, if your whole budget's 624, I would have said it was like, yeah, I would have said one, 100.
37,000.
Came to like 44,000.
So it's 100,000. It's about 20% of your budget.
440,000.
440,000.
So, no, it's okay. I just, you know, again, back to the comparison we used before. Listen, there are some really cool things, like putting in an anaerobic digester and talking to some of the farmers, and instead of dumping old potatoes, you know, down in the dingles. Yeah, sure. There's opportunities to explore, no doubt. But just to put things in, you know, order of magnitude, $100,000 a year is what you're paying right now.
Roughly.
That's not even the annual debt service on a $2 million project. I can tell you that, you know, a digester project, not only are they expensive, you probably need that third partner. You need that public-private partnership along with a grant funding agency. It's not to be dismissed. It's very genuine, but it's not like, you know, if you're all of a sudden you said my sledge budget's going from 100 to 400, now we say, whoa.
Well, didn't it just go from $100,000 to $3,000?
It will. It will be $444 if you have to pay $3,700, yes.
I mean, it sounds like we can't ship anything. I mean, we're getting held hostage.
Yeah.
Where it's going, and we're confident. Am I missing something?
No, but that seems to be happening a lot around this town.
Well, what I'm missing is what the Solid Waste Management District is supposedly doing. Aren't they supposed to be managing our solids and sludge handling?
We signed a new
what
contract.
What are they doing for that 3%? That's what I want to know.
You are in a geography where you yeah. potentially have that partner with the farms, for sure. There's a lot of waste product that could be used to, you know, the byproduct there is, can I make enough energy to make it worthwhile?
Well, what he just said, that was a question. Now, we deal with the county solid waste.
Franklin Regional Solid Waste Management.
Is it something that we couldn't do directly?
We have a contract with them. My understanding is we have a contract with them, and that they, for a 3% flat fee, handle all the wastewater treatment plant sludge handling needs in Western Mass. That they coordinate the bidding process for sludge haulers. They figure out and advocate for places for us to take it to. And they try to get the best rates for us possible. That supposedly is their task for that 3%. But I'm not seeing a result that is reflective of what their goal is supposedly as professed. Right. I don't see that.
And
what I see is don't make waves. We have nowhere else to take it. You know, like recently we had a solids percent solids discrepancy of a magnitude that I had never seen before. And I called Jan Amin out on that, and her response to me essentially, and I have it in email, was don't make waves, let it go, it doesn't matter, it's not enough to make waves about. Do you really want to alienate this hauler and Cranston when this is our only place to take it to over this small amount? So basically shut the hell up and take it.
Well,
how long is that going to go on?
But could you call the people in Cranston and we ship it directly without having the county involved?
Oh, sure.
We can violate a contract.
Well, no, but the contract's not forever, is it?
If I can.
I don't know.
If I could, I believe.
You just proved it.
What's that?
I do believe that, actually that was very specific to the transfer station, nothing to do with wastewater treatment.
Okay.
But anyway, God, where was I going to go with this? Sorry, completely blanked that out.
Sorry.
Sludge truck.
You can go ahead and pull out of it. I do believe, because it's very similar to the one that we just signed.
Exactly.
You can pull out of it. I do not believe there's any type of any fines or violations or anything to be able to pull out of the contract.
Yep.
But yes, no, that's true. We could go ahead and try and negotiate our own.
Let me ask you this: the people who haul this, is it like Greg's? Could they haul it?
No.
No. Mm-hmm. Do you have to have special licenses to do it, or special containers, or both?
9,000 gallon. CDL tanker trucks, full tractor trailers, highly trained people that do it. Hazmat trained, endorsed, all of it.
3% of 100,000 is wholly different from 3% of 444,000. So I think it's now time to look into something separate, because if the fee is jumping that much in 1 year, we're not even budgeting for that. I mean, that's not a budget item. And that's way beyond Finance
Committee
reserve, and so we're
going
to have to go to a special
town meeting
on that.
Everything is kind of in a very short period of time changed. For example, 7 years ago, we were hauling our sludge to Fitchburg, and they were incinerating it. And we did that for years. Fitchburg said the cost of maintaining our incinerator, twin hearth, nine hearth incinerators is too much. We're going to stop doing it. So they shut down. Just like that, they decided to shut down.
Okay, now everybody, every time somebody decides they're going to not do something again, everyone that's, has a need to go there suddenly has to figure out where it's going to go now, on the spur of the moment. There's never any warning about these things. It's always, oh, by the way, we're not taking your sludge anymore, sorry. And now it has to, we all have to scramble to figure out where to haul our sludge to. It's not an option. It has to go somewhere. We have no place to put it.
Sounds like it's gone down to just one option.
It is, right now it is. Exactly. No, that makes me very nervous.
Yeah, there's a lot of plans to take it. It may be that those haulers have, you know, preferred deals with certain, you know, destinations, but Waterbury, I mean, there's a bunch of them in Connecticut.
We had Fitchburg as number one, Upper Blackstone as number two, Cranston, Rhode Island as number three. A couple of years later, Fitchburg was out. Now we have Upper Blackstone and Cranston.
Right.
Then Montague came in. Now it's Montague number one, Upper Blackstone number two, Cranston number three. Then Upper Blackstone said, no, we don't like the garbage in your sludge, and it has to be at least 4% solids. So they moved to number three. Now they're saying they're not taking any of it. So now we're at Cranston waiting for Montague to restart their process and have it be a success again, if and when. But again, I'm trepidatious about putting all our eggs in one basket. I mean, I think we should try to maybe get a little more creative and share, send some loads here, some loads there, just to keep people alive in the game so that we don't go 10 years or 8 years or whatever without giving them anything and then
right.
suddenly expecting them to take this extra volume on a spur of the moment when and if Montague suddenly decides they don't want to do it anymore.
Right, and you're a small plant. A lot of the plants get rid of liquids, but you know, maybe one of the things you can look at in your upcoming planning thing is to consider whether a regional, you know, sludge processing or pre-processing facility might be worthwhile with some other communities and just go to cake. So now you cut your hauling down. You're still paying by the dry ton. You're just taking the trucking element out and, you know, rendering your solid a different form.
Why don't we get back to the presentation so I'll let you get going and, yeah.
Yes, sir.
I have a question. In Hatfield, you mentioned that the taxpayers pay the interest in the deficit.
Correct.
Are people able to dispose of their waste through the plant, or do they have to work out of town?
Not anymore. They were able to take, Hatfield ceased taking septage about 18 months ago. That was in response to some issues with DEP relative to permitting and effluent, et cetera. So those haulers that service the Hatfield communities that are on septic go to other communities. Now there are other options, obviously, locally. I don't know what Deerfield does with, if you provide a discount to septic folks in town. So it's...
I was wondering if they got a better rate. They took...
Not anymore. I don't know if they got a discounted rate before or not. I think that they, everyone coming to Hatfield was paying the same tipping fee per gallon. Hatfield wasn't doing a ton of septage, you know, as long as I've been involved either way. So, but it was enough with a very, very little plant to mess things up. It's a little fixed film RBC plant, you know. Brian was not happy.
I have a couple of questions. I looked at, reviewed the memo and I looked at the scope of work. Item number 8 was the current rate system model, which I think you've done a really good page 3 of the book.
Okay.
That makes what we've been presented so far seems like you've done a lot of work on our existing rate structure.
Yep.
And looking out 9 or 10 years.
Correct.
Based on how we do it. I don't see that item number 9, the alternative rate models, have been presented yet.
The alternative rate systems?
Models. System models.
Evaluated alternative rate systems. The model is the data from the last 3 years is used to develop the model. Any rate alternative is based on that data.
I understand, but I haven't seen an alternative rate system that you presented other than...
Well, the short list, again, I took four or five months worth of you know, discussions and boiled them down into 12 slides.
Well, see, as a committee, we're not privy to any of that discussion, and that would be...
Well, it's a newly established committee, as I understand it, right?
Understand. But I guess my, one of my other requests would be that we have minutes to all those meetings, so that we can know what you looked at.
I don't have meeting minutes from these meetings, but... I could provide you with some type of just cursory overview, but if there are specific alternatives that the committee would like to look at.
I personally would look at the equivalent dwelling unit.
EDUs.
I did look, was brought up by Kevin. I did some look, and it does make a lot of sense for the commercial, industrial, nonprofit. That seems to make a major increase in cost. I mean, users' fees for those individuals. Not so much the commercial or industrial, but schools specifically.
Right.
Private schools, boarding schools, our schools. To me, that makes somewhat sense. Can we get a hybrid of residential with a single rate?
Yeah, we ran that alternative earlier on, not on these two budgets, but we have that very easily, you know, we can... So what we do on the EDUs, basically, is we take the residential customers, and we know what the average residential use is per EDU. A residential single-family home is one EDU.
Yep.
And we use those gallons and extrapolate that gallon equivalent to all of the other customers. And then we assign them the EDU. So
that,
it's a very, very quick number to synthesize.
What you said was that we have such a wide range of use in our residential. So to me, EDUs might not function unless you have subgroups to those EDUs.
Yeah, there wouldn't be a subgroup to residential customers.
Residential customers only.
Yep.
You could, if you're going to use EDUs, you would have a subgroup to those.
For non-residential customers.
For residential.
No.
Okay, so that EDUs don't work in Deerfield for residential customers.
I agree with that.
They very well might work for commercial, industrial,
correct,
and institutional and nonprofits.
The reality of the EDUs for non-residential customers, you're really using the same method because they're gallons, they're high gallon users, and it ends up being the same.
Based on staff, persons, number of pupils, can be based on the number of users.
Yep.
So I mean, I think we need to get away from gallons as much as possible.
I can, we can run the numbers for that. That's my personal opinion. So we'll update the memo to reflect a fixed fee alternative. That's not a problem.
I think there's something that I know the selectman was asked. Actually, they thought they were getting an institutional rate.
It's like I said, you know.
And what I see here in the presentation is really taking our rates, giving us two options on our rate, plus an increase of 15% on anybody that's not residential.
Okay, so just some information, only 8% of the utilities in the state use a fixed fee system.
I read that.
Okay.
But I was trying to figure out but if we're looking at hybrids.
Yep.
Maybe nobody uses a hybrid.
No, the hybrid was one of the alternatives we presented. It's $200 minimum fee. That was based on input that we received. Again, I can output anything I want.
Okay.
You guys collectively owe me the input.
I'll put a memo together.
200 was the...
We can stop the discussion. I don't need to go any further. Understand, but...
Not having such a high minimum rate because most of our elders...
I understand, but I think there's ways of getting there that we haven't even discussed.
Okay.
And as a committee, I think we need to discuss it. I think that what's been proposed shows that in 2027, an individual could be paying a $4,000 sewer bill. And I have no idea, based on what the projected budget increases, how that was established. I would look through the material, I just don't... Seeing we have a capital improvement number that we don't know what it is. It's not presented anywhere other than showing it as an increase in the fee. So
it's been discussed
in your five meetings, but we as a committee have no idea how this was all developed. When I look at it, it looks like we said, fine, we use a flat rate, and we'll charge 15% more, we can gain a little bit of money, but we have a major budget figure that pushes rates to users in 9 or 10 years, 4 to 5 times the current, well, 10 or 7 times the current use.
I get it. There's the data in the back of the report in the appendices.
Yes.
Definitely describes the basis based on the capital plan that was developed on a conceptual basis for how those numbers were derived.
We don't know what that is, so I guess.
No, it's in the report, though, but it's in there. It's in the appendices.
It's in, but not as a dollar value, it's in as a bar graph.
The table there is 3.2B or the capital.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. I didn't, when I looked through it, I didn't.
So I understand, you know, folks have just had a day or two to digest this.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of questions that we're going to have.
You're the bosses, but I would recommend that there's two tasks that I need from the committee or the town collectively in order to try to get to an answer that meets the majority of folks' expectations. Number one, you guys, we need to get in a workshop to review the capital plan. That's the biggest
part of
it.
That's part of our task. I mean, that's part of the issue here, is that we have no idea what the capital plan is. And we have to, part of our task is to review the capital plan, make recommendations. We haven't been presented the capital plan yet. And when you're assuming that we know what is going to happen.
I'm telling you that ahead of the planning evaluation, the team has collectively done their best to estimate the rough magnitude of what this capital would be, having done 10, 20 other plants. You know, on a dollar per gallon basis, where things are going.
So then what we're proposing is not something that is affordable to the single customer, residential customer.
Affordability isn't, I mean, my job is to say, here are your expense projections. Here are rate alternatives that meet those expense, that provide revenue to meet those expense projections. The town's job is to help me refine the 10-year budget, which includes O&M, current capital, none, future capital, and contribution to reserve. I need the input from the town in order to, the numbers are the numbers. It's math.
It sounds like you have the input, and we have a number now that doesn't. Nobody can afford.
I don't have any input from the committee because I don't think
we don't have
a month
input
ago
from anybody. So it does. I mean,
well, we don't really know what anybody can afford. I mean that
$4,000 in 2017.
Well, the Black and Veatch study that I keep referring to,
right,
which is a nationwide study, they quote the EPA as saying that a household with a median income in the United States can afford $100. Sewer plus $80 water per month, which is over $2,000 a year. That's what they say is affordable. Now, when you compare it to what this costs a month, that's not so crazy.
No, two to four.
I think Massachusetts is probably $1,100 bucks a year on average per household for water and sewer, roughly.
Yeah,
water's going to be a little cheaper.
And we're at 400. Water is, we're at 400.
Right.
Oh, I agree that we're very, very low. But
that's why we've not been eligible for anything.
No, but I think that looking out, we can't put all this burden.
No, I agree, and I don't want the minimum.
Nobody's going to live in town.
We have an extreme number of minimum users. But if you look at those minimum users, those are our elders, and so that was why I was interested in the institutional rate and some other combination rate, so that the burden of the increase isn't on our minimum users,
who are
in essence our elders.
And I agree.
Somehow we've got to, we have to translate that somehow.
Well, I think it's going to be some combination.
We need to make it workable.
But if you stop burdening the commercial and industrial, then you're not going to get new industry into town.
I agree with that.
The crux for why this was started, I've been through a lot of wastewater facilities plans and capital upgrades where I've personally failed in the past or where I've seen projects fail. You do an engineering plan, you do a design, and then you get ready to go ask for the money. and then the vote fails. And why did it fail? Because no one did a sensitivity analysis to understand what can we afford, what do we have to do. So this is why the town is trying to do this now, because if the end goal is ultimately, or the objective is, we've got to get enough grants so that the net capital is 10 million or 8 million or 12 million. Now you know you're going through an engineering study that's going to come up with a recommendation that allows you this capital. It's kind of the cart before the horse, but if you let it play out the other way, it's more apt to go down the path of failure than trying to, and this is tough. This is a big group. You all represent the community. I think we have to collectively roll our sleeves up and just refine the assumptions. But one way or the other, significant capital is coming to Deerfield. Whether you decide to move forward sooner or whether things languish and they fail and we're forced to by DEP or EPA. I mean, that's how it plays out, one of those two ways. Yes?
Bruce, I'm sorry.
Let me explain to you something about the enterprise fund. The selectmen agreed to start using the concept of an enterprise fund, but we've never actually voted. We actually do not have a retained earnings account. We have a reserve. And for years, believe it or not, the reserve was a full year's of reserve compared. And I was a selectman for 18 years, and for most of those years, we had at least 1 year saved in advance. Now, what threw a kink into the fact you only have $400,000 now was because they just had to put $400,000 to upgrade the water line in Old Deerfield, or the sewer line in Old Deerfield going out to the plant. But I think, like Carolyn says, we got to be sensitive to our elders, because our, believe it or not, within a few years, we're going to have 60% elders in this town.
I get it.
Like
mm-hmm. now. I get it.
And if you look around this committee, you can see it.
That's true. The statistics are close to that.
So just to make sure we don't misconstrue that we have retained earnings, we don't have retained earnings. Yep. We have a reserve.
Okay. Thank you for the clarity. Okay.
And we should have an enterprise fund.
And at some point, I'd like to talk, if you have time, about the fabled 7 or 9 or 11 or whatever.
I'd like to get back to it, too. Can we talk about
Bruce,
it?
Excuse me, Bruce.
Well, I can understand where you're coming from, Mr. Prickett. You were hired to do an analysis of the system and the potential future costs without personal feeling, which is you're basing your claim on statistics, which is what your job is to do. I can understand the relativity to watching out for the elders. However, you can't kick this can down the road, because they're elders right now, they're going to be more elderly 4 years down the road, when all of a sudden you have to do the steep vertical charge. The infrastructure, we're just talking about the plant. Right. You have the pipelines and everything else that are old. And unfortunately, a lot of the elders live in those areas that they're old pipelines. Myself, I live on a situation where ours are relatively new, so hopefully the maintenance will be minimal for the next 20 years. But you can't kick this problem down the road and soft shell it this year and soft shell it next year. The year after, all of a sudden, you're going to have to triple and quadruple this stuff anyway. As Keith said, your sludge budget, who knows what's going to happen with that, your infrastructure, who knows what the DEP is going to start requiring. You can't kick this down the road. If there's any way of working an abatement system, I don't know, but just that's still going to have to be offset with a rate structure. And so, yes, we do have to keep in mind the taxpayer, but we also have to keep in mind the future taxpayer as well. It's just as important as the present taxpayer. And you don't want people to come into the town and say, well, what's your tax bill? Well, it's $2,500 a year. Holy crap. Well, you know, part of the situation we're in this right now is because sewer rates have been kept artificially low for too many years with the same thing. We can't afford to put the tax burden on the taxpayer, and especially the elders. I understand, but it's going to happen. It's going to happen big time if we don't address it now.
I agree with what Bruce is saying, because the infrastructure has to be there,
right,
regardless of whether the elders are going to be hurt by it or not. We have to have the infrastructure to function as a town.
And I agree completely with both of you. The issue that I see is that the structure that we're looking at doesn't accomplish that. We have to look at something that will accomplish it. Currently, we're trying to put everything on the user, and the user is going to be a minimum payment every year, every $100, they're going to use minimum water if we get the 60% elders on the user system. So my feeling is that we need to look at alternatives relative to schools, nonprofits, potentially industry, and maybe commercial. Not just blanket 15%. I think we have to look at in more detail how we can build our reserves and hopefully an enterprise fund quickly, but still apply for grants to get what we need to get done. And it might need to be in a phased process. We haven't had the chance or the benefit of any presentation of what the potential projects might be in their cost analysis. So we're sitting here just hoping that we can make things work at this point.
I prefaced it at the beginning by saying, you know, this was going to be the first in a series of discussions. I started to mention a little while ago that I would encourage the committee and the town representatives to try to come up with a subgroup to maybe look at the capital plan. I mean, absent a roadmap, which you get through a wastewater facilities plan, right now we're developing a range of capital, which I think is good enough for this discussion. The second thing is, you know, I need some help on what alternatives the group wants to see. There are literally infinite, you know, iterations. On the subcategories, we can essentially have a multiplier for each category, times a rate, you know, and play with that. What's, you know, you have 74% of the customers that are residential that are half the use. And when you get down to that institutional category, it's a relatively small amount of the overall usage. So to impact everyone else by raising their rates, you're looking at, if it's a third of the customers and you want to achieve it all with that one category, it's a three times rate. I mean, it's inverse.
Just as an example to back what you said up, if we were to look at Deerfield Academy by user number, their current enrollment and staff is 838. That's equal to our total users. And they're paying 10-15% of the fee. So we're going to base it on users, or we're going to base it on gallons?
No, users using the system is not the number of people.
Back up, right? This is 800.
Because I got two people in my house, but I'm one user.
Right. Okay. So,
because this is demographics, is the enrollment plus the fact that.
Fine, right.
So that's not.
That's not true to. Right.
Like we're talking. The 882 is customers.
Right.
In other words, buildings.
Could, right.
Against.
Okay.
It could be 3,000 people at those 880.
I apologize for that. But
my
thought process is that these institutions need to be paying more for two-thirds of the water usage in the town in Old Deerfield is used by these private institutions.
But they're built based on usage, right?
Yeah, that's my biggest issue, is that we're relying on two districts to provide us with data.
Assuming the data's right.
Assuming the data's right.
Correct.
And nobody has physically determined or convinced me that the data is accurate, or all the users are included.
That's in water.
I understand that.
If there's other systems feeding some of their uses.
My point.
Not
did you factor in collection system upgrades and repair maintenance?
There's not a lot of capital in there relative to. There's like an annual II piece. I'd have to go back and look at the details. There's the sewer infrastructure related to plant consolidation. There's no sewer expansion per se. It was dealing with the assets that you have today and renewing those assets.
Okay.
But there, I mean, we did include a line item for II rehab,
That's correct. It's one of the this really big chart right here. It's broken down.
That's the one we couldn't read. That's why.
There's new copies here. You've already given us good feedback. I mean, we'll.
Yeah, that's why I was had the inability.
An 8.5 by 14.
I tried with the magnifier.
I have seen your eyes.
I did too.
Bruce, do you have something?
Oh, no.
Okay, I'm Jeff.
Have we really clearly defined what needs to be done and how we're going to do this? Doesn't that impact the rate as far as, you know, we've talked about possibly eliminating the old Deerfield plant. We've talked about bringing the pipeline down, bringing everything to South Deerfield. We've talked about the upgrades that each plant needs. Isn't that going to impact the total dollar amount? And wouldn't that have an impact as far as the sewer rate that we're trying to set? I kind of see that we're trying to set a sewer rate to a little bit of a moving target here. And I'm having trouble with that. I'm having trouble with that concept. I think it'd be, for me, I think it'd be easier to define and assess what we need to do, what we want to do as a town, and then establish that dollar amount, and then establish that sewer rate. Now, I realize that we have to, you know, do something with the sewer rate here at this time, because budget season coming up. But it just seems to me that it would be a little bit easier to actually define how we want to handle this. We've talked about different type of plants. We've talked about, again, upgrading each plant. We've talked about closing old Deerfield, running it down. I think we need to define that and figure out how we're going to do it and where are we going to do and when. And it will make that dollar amount, that total dollar amount that we're looking at, a little bit easier to establish. And it will definitely make the whole process of setting the rate, but also applying for the grants easier, because we'll know what we need specifically. Right now, it seems like it's a moving target to me. I could be off base here.
Kevin?
I agree with Jeff 100%. Let's back up a whole lot. Dave was brought on long before the thought process of this committee even existed. I was requested by the select board to go ahead and try and put together a ballpark idea of which direction do we want to go in, what type of rates are out there. And this is what Dave is trying to present. Last fall, we had three presentations by Weston and Sampson that, whether people looked at, watched, or paid attention to or not, which, again, working with Tony, they're more than willing to come back out again and do this again, but this was the first step is what we're looking for. Just to give you an idea, we're not looking by any means to try and set a rate within the next 3 weeks, month, 2 months. Realistically, you need to get a rate somewhat set for FY17 because technically it's not set right now. Last year, FY16 sewer rates were not set until October. So if we run into the same time frame, so we still have a couple of months, we need to think about what we're going to actually be charging for FY17, which we're already in. One. Two, again, all depends on which direction we want to go in. Again, going back to the Weston and Sampson presentations that have already been done, that Jeff is very well aware of, that he just explained many of them. It depends on which direction you're going in, which tells you, again, I hate to keep saying exactly what he just said, but it's, you have to know what's going on. You have to understand what you want before you can set a rate. But realistically, right now, the reason why this is being presented first, it's informational. So you get a little bit of information here, and by no means is this trying to go ahead and set everything in stone right here. And then we go ahead and have Weston Sampson come back in again, give the presentation again, and then at that, when Weston Sampson gives their presentation, there's options. And then that's when it was my understanding, the select board charged this group to decide which direction do we want to go in.
Right.
You know what I mean? So this is just the first step in many steps that has to happen. I mean, realistically, we've been here an hour and a half and haven't even looked at the book. Press, you know, per se. And that's a pretty thick, there's a lot of information.
We did hire Dave to make recommendations.
Right.
Right? And he made one. And, and the recommendation was that the rate should be raised to $15.40 per 1,000 gallons this year.
Right.
No.
$13.46.
That's where the rates are headed if that capital plan is, as you see it collectively. Your budget, this fiscal year that we're in, is $6.24. Your rate needs to be set at least $7.97 per 1,000 gallons.
Just fiscal.
Just to cover your current budget.
Just to break.
No, just to break, just to break even.
Exactly.
Just to break even. That's
so,
no capital. It
only includes the budget as approved and provided.
Right. And that does not include the new sledge charges. Right.
Does it include any contribution to the retained earnings?
No.
No.
But no new capital, no retained earnings, no sludge. The sludge thing is new to me. I'm dealing with it in Hatfield too right now, but it's the same thing.
Okay, but what was the 1540? What was
that's where it's headed under that scenario.
Headed when?
Next 18.
No, when you get out to that budget. I mean, again.
That was based on our original budget projection.
A 10-year forecast of staggering that debt.
So you're recommending that we stagger the increase to 1540 over.
No, tonight I'm recommending that you stay. We're recommending you stay with the current rate structure, increase your minimum fees, and in this fiscal year set your rate at $7.97. That's what we're recommending now. You need to collectively confirm where you want the budget to go, particularly capital debt service, future debt service, and contribution to retained earnings. Those two elements will add on to O&M. O&M has been very well vetted in the last 8 months, in my opinion.
And after that, we can come up with a methodology.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's not the rate.
Tony can help
tell you. It's the methodology we need to look at.
The path that you decide may be the debt hits you in 5 years. Half of it may hit you in 3 and the other half in 6 years. Those are all decisions that you can make.
We
can update the scenarios to cover that. We may see a reaction from the public in using less water, too, believe it or not, as the rates go up. People may become more...
What happens in that case with the fixed costs? How do they get covered if they use less water?
You don't. I mean,
you got to raise the rate the following year.
That's one of the sensitivities we did in there. We've got some curves in the back that show if water goes down 5%, 10%, it's linear. I mean, it's inversely linear. You got to grab that on the other side.
Isn't that the argument for having a flat rate?
I love flat rate systems. Great Barrington's one of my clients. They have it. I can tell you that I have 10 or 20 seniors that I'm ready for them to lynch me in the parking lot every time we leave those discussions. Because, you know, there was a woman whose husband passed away years ago. She was in her 80s. She's in a 3,000 square foot house all by herself, and she uses 20 gallons of water a day. And she's paying, you know, $700 a year for sewer. Is it fair and equitable? You can get 80% of your users happy with the structure, the 10 on either side, there's always going to be outliers.
Do any towns give an abatement for seniors that did it at the minimum?
Absolutely. It's completely fair to have that. You would, again, identify that risk of the abatement program and hedge that and put that money back on the other 95% of the population. But there's definitely precedent for senior discounts. I think it's only 10% in the state right now, roughly. But Great Barrington's putting one into place right now. It's the same thing. Lennox likely will be doing the same thing. We have an aging population.
Not all seniors qualify.
They're all still working.
Not all seniors qualify.
Sure.
I have one other question. Actually two. In your rate analysis, when you looked at 27.
Yep.
You had a rate per 1,000 gallons for residential of $41.56.
Yeah.
And we're looking that rate to flatten over the rate of at least anywhere, depending on what grant we were to get. You used SRF, which is a loan.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a loan-based, no matter what you do, you're 2027, you receive all that as a loan. You're at 41.56 for at least for the next 10 to 15 years after that. So we're looking at a tax bill, like I stated earlier, of $4,000 to $5,000 just for sewer.
That's right.
Residential unit.
if your rate is X right now and your budget's going to go up by 5X, your rate's going
to
be 5X.
I just think we need to be clear on that. I mean, that's what this study is.
But it is what it is.
But then,
that's based on a first-cut capital outlay.
I understand, which we don't know. The second
Correct.
Question I had is, you said there's a possibility you have a method to eliminate abatements. Could you give us a memo on how abatements could be eliminated?
Could be eliminated?
Yes.
You would just, it would be decided that you would not no but, longer be.
But that way you would
That's
charge,
a policy. That's not a.
You would charge everybody for total water usage.
Yeah.
While they did water the lawn or fill
right.
the pool.
And the flip side of that, I mean, I live in Long Meadow. I pay my sewer bills based on my water consumption, period.
So it's a Wilmington, Mass.
There's
so
no, you know, there's no abatement. In that case, when there are no abatements, the rate actually goes down a little bit because you're no longer, you know, subsidize. Thank you. Better word than hedging. Yeah, subsidize.
Bruce?
Well, back to you. We talked about the 694 rate. I'm reading on page 6 of this. Therefore, it came to the same state as our term is based on O&M and capital line allocations in order to fund the revised budget as well as preliminary capital costs. The updated wastewater rate was adjusted to 974 per thousand with a minimum fee of $100 per building.
Yep.
Per billing. So what was that sentence referring to? If you're going to do any capital improvements at all, and that line just got dropped right out?
It would be above and beyond that, right?
Yep.
That was based kind of solely on where we're at now. I mean, there were a lot of moving parts, so what we did, you know, the last 2 weeks is pull it back to last year, this year, and maybe next year, because I don't think collectively anybody's really ready to look out 5 years, let alone 10. I mean, 10's a long time in budget projections, particularly prior to having a publicly vetted capital plan for wastewater.
Keith?
I would just like to make a comment that although I think it's very important to have accurate and complete information in making this decision about large sums of money for the whole town, that this information does not come free either. And I know that some of the engineering firms that have been paid visits and given presentations here in the past have done so somewhat pro bono, but I'm also aware as of today that, for example, if Weston & Sampson comes out to represent, that's another $135,000. So this information gathering
to do
is costing money, and I keep hearing about, you know, elders not being able to pay and things like that, and I get it. However, you know, this information is also starting to add up a little bit too.
Keith, can you clarify the 135?
I received a communication that I've been engaged in with Tony Lisimo, which he gave me a cost analysis for scope of work involved in starting a new comprehensive wastewater management plan.
Why would we need that? We already have it.
Yeah, it's 15 years old.
And how much was paid for that? And nothing was done based on those.
What was the money that building, that project that I saw in the office, what started that?
Which one? Because
the Headworks project.
Okay, I was going to say, because there's two boxes worth of
old stuff.
Studies that we paid for in the past that we've never done anything with.
Right.
And we've paid, I'm going to throw an arbitrary number, a couple hundred thousand dollars.
More than that. Yep.
So, and obviously I'm well under, and these are just things that we've done. And unfortunately, this is my own personal opinion, we have continually kicked the can down the road. Why are we at this point right now? Why do these rates have to go so outrageous? It's because we were penny wise and dollar foolish long ago. We were trying to do the right thing by the people, but unfortunately the last two generations got off, and it's going to be the next three generations that are going to end up paying.
Well, I don't know. I kind of take a whole different approach to all this. I've been listening and staying kind of quiet, and no disrespect to these people, but the bottom line is that you have to charge money. And we respectfully have listened to a lot of good ideas, but it's up to us to come up with an idea how much we're going to charge and to what ratio we're going to charge residents and commercials. Should we group the schools and residential, I mean, the schools and the commercial, industrial altogether. But it's just a dollar. We got to put a dollar value to that, to what we're currently spending. Now, that should be independent, I think, from going forward, what is going to be, you know, our expenditures going forward. Now, you can talk about a plan, but you need to have that rate structure in hand. So if the Headworks project, I'm just going to use the number out there, if it's going to be $3 million, but the state is going to pay for it all, then okay, our rate structure, whatever we come up with, will stay the same, and we can start thinking about what kind of infrastructures are we going to be looking at for pipes. Where do we start laying the pipes? Do we start the plant and work backwards, you know, or do you start over here and work toward the plant? And then how much is it going to cost? Can we apply for, you know, grants for that? And work, you know, kind of like in piecework. Because I don't think that the town could ever afford to do the whole thing and just go in and say, do it. If it's going to be $300 million, we just can't do it. And so I think that it'd be wise just to take the information that we've gotten, not lay out more money to get more information and just start. We know we got to work on the plants. You know, we got to make a determination. Do we want to close one plant and put a pump station, or just, you know, rehabilitate them both and go forward like that? But, you know, always we have to keep, you know, the tax rate, you know, in I understand about kicking the can down the road, and I'm not suggesting that. So we need to make a plan and go forward with, but it has to be small steps at a time, because anything larger, it won't fly. And the people can afford it.
If you make a plan and everyone's comfortable with the plan on all counts, as far as what's going to be done and how much it's going to cost and how that's going to be funded, then I think it's really important that whoever finally votes on that, I guess the town mm-hmm. vote on that,
yes.
delivers on it and actually does it instead of spending $500,000 to explore all these ideas and get it all bound up and put in a drawer somewhere, and then nobody does anything with it.
And I can't agree with you more, but my point was is that I think a lot of things have been, I don't know if I can say, blown out of proportion. It's like, these folks made a great presentation, but to me, it's as simple as, you know, we just got to figure out how, and we look to them for some information. Spending more money to do more studies is just crazy. You know, just we got to sit down and figure out what it is we're going to do. And then if we need to do the Headworks project, and if it's going to be funded 100% or 50%, then we have to address that. How are we going to do this, you know? And not kick the can down the road, just, you know, pick a part that's the most important part and go forward with that. And I also think it's important to set some money aside, you know, to have a reserve fund or a capital improvement fund as we go along, too, but not turn around like this town has historically done. And here again, no offense, turned it, you know, we take hundreds of thousands of dollars that we've collected to fix something and we put it into another study, you know.
Make it a bill, like yeah. pay yourself first.
John.
I think we should set the rate for this current fiscal year using the current methodology, tweak the budget they used to come up with the amount they did, and then later on, after we get an idea what the capital, what we're going to be spending on capital, then come back and discuss with them what methodology we should use based on the millions we're going to have to spend for whatever millions we're going to have to spend on capital projects.
The only tweak that I'd like to make to that is that I think it's important that we, prior to actually setting a rate, is to see if we want to, how we want to deal with the, whether you call it an institutional rate or whatever, to look at the schools and, you know, the commercial and industrial, and kind of, I don't say lump them together, but see how we want to set that. And also check into, you know, if the schools are paying their fair share, if this metering thing is all working out right, you know.
I disagree with that. Why okay. change the methodology? Say we change it this year and we give the industrial a different rate mm-hmm. for fiscal year 2017. Yep. And then we come back with a with a final methodology, and now we're going to change the way we do it again. I think we should just leave it as is. That's my feeling.
Maybe what I should have said is that in investigating the school situation, whether it be our public schools or the private schools, we might find that, in fact, that the cost of treating the sewage is not being compensated properly. And that's why I say that we should at least consider making an adjustment, but not until we find out. If it is, if it's all equal, then that's fine. I agree with you. But if we find that, you know, it's costing more in Old Deerfield than South Deerfield, and it's primarily because of the private schools are the biggest users, then what that really leads to is that the people in South Deerfield are subsidizing the people mm-hmm. over there. And that's not fair. I don't think it is.
When do the next round of sewer bills go out for 2017?
I don't have a clue.
Usually October or so. They want to get the money in before the end of the year.
So we would have to, if you want to do what you're going to do, we'd have to do it
no.
before October.
Right.
Well, before the bills go out.
The selectmen decided to use the existing rate structure for the common bills.
For, right, yeah. then you're talking
for right now. But we're looking for 2018.
I thought you were talking now.
We agreed to keep it the same for 2017. But we also are going to notify at least all the municipal buildings that's going to change for 2018.
17, I thought.
No, 17 is going to stay the same.
The same rate?
Everything's going to stay as
same
it is.
Same rate in the city?
No.
The 17 were decided was not charged until municipal
right, that's right. Right, we didn't.
The Select Board has not yet set a rate for fiscal 17.
No, we have not.
Right.
I guess I'm not being clear. That.
So on my opinion.
Go ahead.
You gave your recommendation 694. If that covers all the costs because of the increase in budget to 560,000, then you go for the 794 and make sure you add in money to go into the reserve. Now, beyond that, I don't think any other changes are necessary other than notifying all the Holy Seven that they're going to start getting bills next year.
Okay. I agree with you.
Okay.
With you. I agree. Any kind of maintenance that needs to be done? Are we also going to have a separate plan to work on the headworks and start
the headworks engineering is already going on right now.
No, I know, but I mean, are we going to start?
And we're going to, I thought they already said they were going to apply for a grant.
Yes.
That's
now, if they've applied for a grant and this thing comes in, then it'll come to a head, and then we have to decide, how are we paying for it?
Right. I know that stuff needs to start getting worked on.
We're working on it right now. Yeah. We just don't know what the cost is going to be for the town of Deerfield yet.
But as far as the rates, as far as what we're talking about today, the rate study, it's pretty clear that the rates have to go up.
Yeah, they do.
They just have to.
Yes.
And they have to go up a lot.
Well, it depends upon whether you want to accept Weston and Sampson's engineering report saying you got to put $32 million in, or their engineering report saying you got to put $52 million in.
There's never been
but
a
we're not putting it in.
Either way, I think we got to take that $32 million or $52 million list and prioritize it.
But it's not going to happen.
I'm sorry, Mr. Pereski. Is it Pereski?
No,
Pritchard. I'm Pereski.
Jack. I'm sorry. You keep bringing up this $52 million. I don't know where you heard that, but it wasn't from Weston and Sampson, and it was not in an official capacity. And I have that information straight from Weston and Sampson today. So to keep throwing around a large figure like that, in my opinion, is a scare tactic and is not constructive. It is alarmist and it is unfair because it's not accurate.
What, the $32 million?
$52 million. You keep bringing that up. And I'm really starting to take issue with it because
it's not
an accurate
figure.
I
don't think it's accurate either.
You know, I don't
that's assuming we're going to Greenfield and we're going to take Sunderland and move it over to us.
Okay, well, no one knows where you got that from, including supposedly the source you keep citing. So I have issue with that. It's not fair to keep saying that figure when it is not based in fact.
Why don't we take this year, fiscal 2017, and get that set, and then after we decide what we're going to do with the plants, then come back with the rate study and the methodology. Let's take it a step at a time. Mm-hmm. We keep talking about 5 years from now. We have no idea.
It's just baby steps.
Carolyn?
Yeah, baby steps.
Can I just ask, did the MassWorks actually get submitted?
The MassWorks application is still in progress. I am still waiting
for sample letters that can be filled out by municipal partners, local nonprofits, local businesses, and so on and so forth. That's the last step in the game.
But one of the reasons you have to justify why it is really important for us to get this grant, and it's really important from the letters, and I will work with you, but we need to make a list. We've got to go to the Connecticut River Watershed Council, we've got to go to Trouts Unlimited, we've got to get letters of support from the Long Island Sound Initiative, Connecticut Conservation Association, Conservation District Association, everybody that's impacted, that if our sewer plants fail, they are getting all the crap. And so this is really, really, really important that they'll get letters of support, because that gets us the grant.
The actually, the recommendation from Weston and Sampson was to get letters of support from local industry, local business, including New England Natural Bakers, including the folks who are in the industrial park, including businesses on Route 5 and 10, including some of the landowners who could benefit financially from an expansion of the sewer plant, which is phase 2, 3, 4 down the line, because that, according to Tony from Weston and Sampson, is going to better support the grant application.
Absolutely.
The economic development.
This is the important part. Who is overseeing this submission?
That's Weston and Sampson. That's part of what we're paying them to do.
Okay. So for sure, they're doing this package.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And I understand also that at the last minute session on the 31st, that the Senate approved the MassWorks grant. So I think that's $50 million that is now approved for expenditure this coming year. So we need to file this. Without that,
okay.
The money has been sent to the group.
Okay.
We need to file this.
I can just say, from my experience working with MassWorks submission, it is very important to have those letters of support.
Absolutely.
That's key.
Absolutely.
To get it. I mean, we went through all kinds of stuff on River Road. We had Greenfield and Montague. It was an emergency route. I mean, you make up your story.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have your story, and you've got to be sure that that's included.
Doug, is there a specific date that that grant has to be filed, or the application for the grant has to be filed?
It's the 24th to the 5th. It's an open window.
August 24th to September 5th.
Okay, so this is
this
really
is actually,
critical.
We're coming down the wire. We need to get these letters out.
Okay.
All right, I'll reach out to
sooner
Tony
the
tomorrow.
I just reach out to
the stories.
Yeah.
We need to get last week. He was supposed to provide them right away.
Okay,
so.
Well, this is really key to reach out to all the partners. Okay. I'll make sure. We'll make sure this happens by next week.
Bruce?
We made a request as a sewer study committee to have a copy of the plans and the application. And the cost estimate
for
the headworks. We haven't received it yet. There's a whole. I have a list of items that we've requested but haven't received. But I'll give that. One of them was a presentation of Weston and Sampson, which we requested July 25th, and we're supposed to get some information so we can view it on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that we haven't asked for information, and we just sometimes, like there's boxes we have to go through. So my point is that there's a lot of data to research, and we need to get it.
You're getting it, Bruce.
I know that's there. What I asked for was the headworks and the cost estimate, which is not that. And that is fine to put that in front of the committee and say, take a good look, evaluate it. This is all we got.
It's we have just, that from last year, Kevin?
What's that?
The original works.
No,
it was,
buying.
It's
Bruce, Stuart, I have great respect for all you're doing, but shouldn't we be talking about rates while these guys are here?
I understand. I agree 100%.
Yep.
I'm sorry, we got off several times.
Yeah.
You have more to go, I think.
What's
no,
that?
You have more to go, I take it.
No, we're done. It's you.
Are we
as long as you want.
I mean, maybe I should make a motion.
Right.
I make a motion that we set a rate for 2017 using the current methodology based on a projected budget that may need to be tweaked, and that we come back with a new methodology once we come up with a capital plan.
And add in for reserves.
That'd be part of the methodology, I guess.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
What was the rate you suggested?
I'm not suggesting a rate, based on the projected budget.
The rest of that is simply...
Tweaked.
Well, simply...
We need to tweak it, because I guess there was a sludge factor that was maybe incorrect in your numbers.
Sludge and whether you decide to contribute to reserve or not.
Right.
And we have a... So we had a, everybody voted...
One abstention.
One abstention?
You abstain, Bob?
I just want a clarification.
Oh, so it wasn't abstention.
I'm just trying to come back for a further vote.
Yes. But we don't, we, all we would do is make a, I don't even know if we make a dollar recommendation. Is that something the committee, we're discussing it?
Sure, maybe not.
If the budget's going to be adjusted, it has to go back to town meeting.
I would advise you not to make the dollar...
Exactly.
The total dollar, we're talking about projection, projected budget.
For FY18.
And let the selectmen set the rate.
No, 2017.
We're just talking about the...
You're currently operating approved budget from your town meeting is $624.
Right.
That only represents one line item of four, just O&M. It's just O&M.
But isn't that wrong?
Yes.
The 624? No, the 624 is in a, I mean, that's the approved...
No, I mean, that's maybe what got voted.
$624,000?
That's the vote.
Maybe that's what we got voted, but with hindsight...
$600,000 is the budget.
Maybe that's what got voted. Maybe that's what got voted, but with hindsight, maybe it was too low.
So in other words, you're talking about adjusting the appropriation?
No, we're talking about the amount of money we're projecting we have to spend in order to set a rate.
That requires a vote of town meeting. If you're going to adjust the budget, even if you're going to take some money and bankroll it into a capital reserve, that still requires adjusting the budget. We can do that at a special town meeting in the fall. I'm simply saying that that is one step that will have to be considered.
All you need to do is a rate hearing, presumably.
Well, the select will do a rate hearing, yes, absolutely, that's a public hearing, it's a rate hearing, they have to do that before they set the rate. If we're talking about adjusting the budget to allow for greater capital allocation...
No, I'm not saying capital.
No.
Whatever.
Can I clarify the motion? It was for, to maintain the current methodology, which is a single-payer rate structure. And then when we have more information on capital costs, revisit the rate again.
And give them another recommendation.
And a new recommendation, which would include potentially money for reserve.
Yes.
So the issue is, this is, we're talking about the rate that will be set by the selectmen for 2017.
Yes.
For the next month or so.
Yes. And so they'll come up with a number, which they'll base on the budget.
Yep.
I got a budget here that for estimated fiscal year 17 budget for the wastewater treatment plant, which is $760,000, which is not, it's a 43% increase over 16. That's projected. Understand, projected.
Eighteen.
That's 18.
Says 17 on the chart.
I don't have that chart in front of me.
It was out of the book.
Yeah, but Bruce, that might actually be more accurate because it's a sludge...
No, I realize that, but I'm just saying, that's fine, but that's how you're gonna, that's how you're gonna set the rate. Based on a projected budget that the finance committee will have, and no, we're gonna use it on, the finance committee's not gonna review it. You're gonna set a rate based on what you think it's going to be in a projected budget for the wastewater treatment plant.
Based on...
You're keeping your current rate, which is a little different than what we recommended, by adjusting your minimum fee. We will provide a concise, updated recommendation of what we believe you need to set your fiscal 17 rate at, based on our understanding of the budget for 17. If the budget isn't right, you guys adjust accordingly, and it is a linear adjustment.
Can we do that?
I don't think, I
I don't think the motion was to set the rate.
No, I completely understand, but because you're...
Just methodology.
Your methodology was to keep the current rate structure in its entirety, the minimum fees where they're at.
Yep.
So I need to give, we need to give you an updated dollar per thousand gallons that you can then deliberate later on with the select board.
But this is only a recommendation to the selectmen. Selectmen say, fine, we're going to use the current methodology, but we're going to change all the rates. We're going to change the minimum rate.
Including
the minimum rate, including anything else. So I wouldn't waste creating a number for the selectmen.
You guys tell me when you're ready.
We're ready.
Why wouldn't we want its recommendation of, I don't understand why we wouldn't want...
Because it's going to be based on a minimum, no minimum, the old minimum charge, which doesn't make any sense, in my feeling.
We're talking 1 year.
100 per period.
Well, 65 now, and right now the current methodology is a charge 65. The selectmen have the ability to charge 100.
Right. But we're talking about the keeping the current methodology, but increasing the minimum fee to $100.
Well, that's what they need to know. That's what the selectmen need to tell them. We didn't vote on that.
Right. We voted on keeping the same methodology, which
keeping
would be the
same
minimum.
Methodology.
That'd be the same minimum.
Methodology is that there's a single rate, and there's a minimum charge, and there's an abatement. Those are the three portions of the methodology.
No numbers.
No dollars.
Okay.
That's for discussion.
We can't, for clarification, the total that we have to fund with the rate, collect, can't change. That can't change, right?
You're going back.
Unless you are going over the end, the sewer budget, a special town meeting.
Right, we're not going back.
Okay.
And if you feel...
If there's an emergency, they can take it out of your...
If it's money.
But you can set the rate, you can set the rate higher to create a reserve, or
absolutely,
to contribute to a reserve, which we know we're going to need.
Yeah. We can't, because it wasn't voted.
No, we're talking going forward.
No,
I'm talking about 2017.
If you need $100.
17.
It's 2017, that's where we're now.
That's, we can't do anything.
But the rate hasn't been, the dollar amount of the rate has not been set.
No, that's what they're going to do. Because these guys are all math professors.
But that's what I thought, that's what we were talking about.
Because they have the power to do
the numbers.
But
it's going to be a town vote.
I guess the confusion is...
Bruce.
Okay.
First off, that's the reason for keeping...
Part of the problem is you have a fiscal year and a sewer bill. First off, we have to iron out where we're talking about.
Right.
All right, because we have a fiscal year and we have a sewer bill year. So what is set and what is not set in relation to 2017 that already exists?
I think the answer is the total appropriation is set for the town, but for a fiscal year.
Okay.
The rate has not been set for 2017.
Okay, that's starting in...
July 1st.
No, it's not a July rate. It's an October through...
It's October to May.
May.
What I'm saying.
Well, for the two bills.
Yeah, but that's how the rate is established. Way off of any fiscal year, calendar year, sewer year, anything.
Exactly. So we got to focus on where we're at first.
Right.
And I'm confused at that.
I am too.
Well, your sewer budget aligns with your town's fiscal year. And your two revenue collections occur within the fiscal year.
The sewer bill comes out 3 months later, that's all.
They both come within the fiscal year.
Yeah, it's not the same year.
But it laps over on the back end.
Yeah. No, it doesn't.
Well, the money
doesn't.
But the usage does.
October and May.
The usage does, but the money doesn't. The money, the billing cycles coincide with the fiscal year.
So what you're saying, Bruce, is the water meter should be read on July 1.
Okay. Let me try to can I follow up with Bruce?
Sure.
Please do.
Okay. The second bill is May, right?
Yes.
Our fiscal year ends June 30th. So we make a collection in May, and all that money hopefully is paid in that time frame to pay for bills already occurred.
Right.
In 17.
We've already taken it out of reserve to pay for it. So what it does, it replenishes the reserve.
So we're using reserve to pay?
What happens is, right now, you're using reserve right now to pay these guys to work.
Okay, so then...
Just don't pay the vendors.
So then the rate we set is going to be based on what the budget was.
Right.
Right.
And...
Two bills per year.
If the selectmen want to change anything relative to minimum or add to the reserve, they can do that and increase the rate.
They can do that in a future rate if they have to.
Does the town, if we change the methodology for this 1 year, does it have to go to town meeting?
No.
If we increase the minimum but decrease the use...
You can collect more money than you spend.
We usually try and collect more money.
Exactly. So it doesn't make any difference.
I think, broadly speaking, yes, you can. The question is, can you intentionally do it? Can you separate that puts your collections at about $100,000 higher than...
I mean, there's three, there's been two or three years that one department has done that. Intentionally.
Whether that was intentional or not is up to debate.
Okay.
That's my question, is can you say, well, we only know we're going to spend $100 this year, can we set rates to collect $150 this year?
If we know that the budget, the 674, is that the number?
624.
624 was too low, because now we have more hindsight available.
Yeah.
I think we need to get an answer as to whether we can...
You can go to the select...
Bill more than 624.
Request them to set up a special town meeting.
Without a special town meeting. Maybe we can do it, we don't know. It's a legal question.
I think it's a question for council.
Right. And if we can do it, I think we should do it.
Well, there has to be some way to cover the sludge costs.
Right.
That is unexpected, and it is a new cost.
You should cover the sludge cost, your potential abatements, and a potential decrease in usage based on an increase in cost. Now, that said, your revenues should be up for this coming half because of the summer that we've had so far. People are using more water.
But we're giving them abatements.
It's your choice.
We've already voted for current methodology, that's not...
But they're not, it's that abatement is water that is not going through the sewer system.
I understand that. But you could have...
And if you want to get into that...
No, I don't.
Consider that, I think Frontier has 2 meters to begin.
They do.
The abatement is also...
I want to talk about that, Bruce, I want to get into that right now. Okay? Where did you come up with the fact that Frontier doesn't pay water?
Information were provided by the town.
Frontier pays a very small...
I think they pay like $2,500 a year or something.
I think you probably find that fresh will copy the bill, the check, and I thought it was, could be wrong, $3,500 for the period last fall, in November or so.
That would be for one bill period for sewer?
Yeah, because Frontier's only responsible for paying what actually goes in the sewer. They have the irrigation system in the fields.
And it's on a separate meter.
Yeah.
And it's on a separate meter.
And the problem is, Bob...
The water bill for Frontier is at 35 million gallons for the year.
But I haven't seen the... I want to see the rest of the detail, because you apply, they don't pay anything. And they have been paying what they did bill.
Make your life easy. If you can show people that we're not going to have abatements, so everyone's rates are 5% lower than they would be. If you want to have an abatement program and deal with it at meetings and have staff spend time, you can. That means that everyone else's rates are 5% higher. It's pretty linear, the relationship. It's just a decision. It's a policy decision.
My other question is, in all your analysis here, have you got anything in here on connection fees or new growth and impact fees or major expansions and whatever is going into the system?
We didn't have anything in there relative to the facility connection charge or system development charge.
That
it wasn't within the scope of the project,
It's a way of coming up with additional revenue.
But you would have to be qualified as unanticipated revenue. You can't put that into a budget in the same way.
But it's there the following year, Doug.
It is there the following year, and it helps to be a capital fund, absolutely.
Yeah.
Or your reserves, but you don't count on that as part of your revenue funding model.
Kevin.
Just so you're aware, in the past, our sewer connection fee was...
$25.
Yeah, $25. Okay, and we did, the select board has changed that. Basically, what we do now is we go off of your Title V usage, and that's where we project the gallonage, and then they went ahead and they set a price towards the gallonage, and that is now where your new connection fee will come into play. So...
How do you calculate what a cut...
Okay, you say, okay, well, you know, he's got a household of four people, and this is ballpark. Okay, you let me ask you this. You put in septic systems, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so how do you figure how much flow is going to be in there?
You go by how many bedrooms, sir.
Title V by bedroom, so it is right here.
Okay.
So that's... It's a standard calculator that you can use for residential...
It's all in there, Kip. That's Title V.
Yeah.
So there's a gallonage that goes by how many bedroom, correct?
Yep.
Okay, so with this system that we have now, is there's drop-down menus. You can go and say, okay, well, I've got a school with a cafeteria, without a cafeteria, without a gym, with showers, without showers. I've got a gas station with restrooms, without restrooms. Is there food preparation in there? These are all drop downs, and all of these come into a calculation that the state of Massachusetts utilizes for setting a gallons per capita, per person. It is. And then the select board has already set a rate per gallon. And that is how, per gallon, and that is how you come up with your sewer connection fee. I forget
which town it was, but we copied the best.
Seems basically, it was Buzzard Bay is what we did.
I understand the gallons usage, the water coming in, and that could be billed, but the connection, why not have a flat, you know, like $3,000 or $4,000 fee?
You can do that.
That seems so much simpler.
That wasn't the choice the select board wanted.
$4,000 fee, whether or not it's a single-family residence.
Regardless.
If it's another virtue.
You can base it on the size of connection.
That's what I was going to say. If it's a 4-inch connection, which is a minimum, that's going to be $3,000. I'm just picking these numbers.
Yeah.
If it's going to be a 5-inch, it's going to be $5,000. If it's a 6-inch, it's going to be $8,000.
That's where it should be.
You can do whatever you want.
What's that? Yeah, but that, because now you're just talking about it's a fee to help for the infrastructure and the cost of that connection. And that's only to the town property, you know. And then you get charged accordingly for the same thing.
And I agree wholeheartedly, and that's why we went ahead and we collectively sat down and we looked at, Hadley does very similar to what you just said.
Yeah.
That was presented to the select board. And then we came up with this Title V gallonages on looking at that direction. So they looked at that. And then there was a third option. I can't remember off the top of my head. They looked at it, and out of the three options that were there, that is what they decided to pick at that point in time. Now we have a new regime, so you guys can go ahead and you can change whatever you want. I mean, that's my understanding is that's what this whole thing is all about.
How many sewer connections have we done? We've got one coming up, which is...
Since then, we've had two. You know, and one of them, you know, residential was a two family.
Exactly.
And what they ended up doing was they went and came and got their sewer connection fee 7 days before the rates came out differently. So they paid $25 instead of about $5,500.
You've had one new sewer customer in the last 3 years.
Yeah.
The technical basis for that, though, on that system development charge is the value of your wastewater assets, your pipes and your plant, and you have that from your accounting, divided by the number of EDUs served by the system.
Yep.
So when it gets challenged, that's the basis to determine whether it's realistic.
Understood.
So most communities are somewhere between $25 and $7,500 per connection.
Yeah. What a difference.
And people complain, but then you find out what does it cost to put a septic system in?
Right.
Oh, exactly.
At least 15, 20 grand. So
it goes back a few years when Waitley was putting in their town water system. I mean, they did it, but every house had to connect, and every house had to pay $5,000. And that was just the way. And that's how they paid for a good portion of it.
You should have three fees, every utility. The system development charge, the connection, how much you're going to pay to buy into the capacity, a minimum fee to have Kevin's staff look at the lateral or Keith's staff look at the lateral, make sure it's properly installed before it's backfilled, and then your O&M charge on an annual basis. Every utility should have all those three.
One of the real big things you need to keep in the back of your mind, what we liked about the theory of going with almost like, I don't want to use a sliding scale, but the present system we're using right now. Okay, say hypothetically another Berkshire Brew comes in and they've got an 8-inch, okay? Well, we're going to charge them $2,000, okay? Well, think about how much water or sewage that they go ahead. Now, let's just say hypothetically, I know it's never going to happen in this town, but let's say we go ahead and we have a 300-room hotel come in, and they've got a 6-inch, and you do by the size, now you've just, to your disadvantage, because you've gone by sizing the piping, you know what I'm saying?
There's a minimum.
You go the other way, then that way there's more money. I mean, because you go out to like someplace like Lexington or someplace like that, when they go ahead and they build a big hotel, it's $25,000 or $30,000 just for a sewer hookup fee. You know what I'm saying? So you need to think about the whole process, and you also need to think about where is the town going to be in the future, because once again, going to the theory of this person came in, instead of paying $5,500 for a sewer charge, they came in and paid $25 because they saw what was going on, they saw writing on the wall, went ahead and paid it before they had to, and now the town realistically lost $5,450. So it's just something you need to keep in your back of your mind when you're looking at all this stuff. Again, this is all just very broad, very, you know, it's up to the committee to decide which direction you go. And then it's up to the select board, because they're the commissioners, as to what they actually want to implement.
There is a real value to that. But, you know, back to your scenario, I mean, those numbers wouldn't work that way, because the flow rate would be different for both separate buildings.
It's not just the flow either, it's the strength.
It's the strength of what it is.
A brewery would put out much more potent, hard-to-treat waste than domestic wastewater from a hotel.
Well, I guess that's something different that you can look at. But as far as the actual connection, you know, I feel that a lot of times we try to, we get on a topic of something, and then we bring in all these other factors, and, you know, that's what makes it difficult.
Yeah. I agree.
One last point to back up Kip.
Yep.
Just one last point back up Kip. We can charge surcharges to industries or areas that cause the problems that you talked about.
Yeah.
Case.
The higher the strength, the more it costs.
And Montague does that.
Didn't we used to do it for Oxford Pickle?
Do we surcharge Oxford?
Can I make a comment before we end up adjourning? I want to compliment these guys for doing a good job.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your time. Thank you.
Can I?
Oh, this is part of the process.
Can I make
this? So we'll be contacting them after we've finished our capital plan, right?
Well, we have more idea of our capital. Okay. I mean, we might get the MassWorks grant closes relatively soon.
No, I'm talking about the 10-year plan.
Oh.
Kevin.
Something you may want to keep in the back of your mind. I would probably look into how Old Deerfield Water District or Deerfield Fire Water, how they calculate all of their special little fees that they add in. I think it would be very beneficial to this committee to look at how they do it, because it seems like there's quite a few little loopholes that you have to jump through with them that obviously has worked in town.
Okay. Anything else?
Is there any way of measuring the true flow through this plant?
We do it every day.
Every day.
You do it required to do that 20%.
How does that compare with the water usage before abatements and the water usage after abatements?
We haven't done that calculation.
No, we haven't.
Because that would be a good scenario as to, you know, whether the abatements that are being offered are valid or not.
Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Just look at your flow. Just look at last month's flow.
So, well, that would touch
validated itself for your regular
your flow.
Yeah.
That would tell to a certain degree. I understand there's a certain amount of inflow from floor drains and everything else, but
you mean the floor drains that we're not supposed to have? Floor drains that are illegal? No floor drains are supposed to be attached to our wastewater treatment system.
The town went through, supposedly smoked everything and sealed them all up because that was part and parcel of it.
they paid individuals, volunteered to accept a fee to...
They also supposedly smoked a...
They smoked them, but they didn't, there was no mandate for everybody in town to do it, other than accept the money and put a sump pump in.
Well, I think the other part of that, when they're doing smoking, and I hate to go across, it's, that was to find out also who also was hooked into with waste, with the sump pumps. Because I know, like me, I've got three in my house, and the town allotted me $600 to put my piping out to my backyard and put under drywall.
Yep.
So, 500.
That was six.
500 max.
Whatever it was, 500.
Motion to adjourn.
All I do know is the money did not add up to how much.
What have we concluded tonight?
Nothing.
We needed a lot more.
We agreed to disagree.
No, but I mean, right, we...
That we need to focus on the rates for 217 Toronto, and then get on the rest of this stuff.
So, we need to...
When's our next meeting?
That's, we need to set an agenda and schedule a next meeting.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes.
When would you like to have Weston and Sampson in for your presentation?
Well, it was gonna cost them $135,000.
No, just take that part out, just right out of your head, pretend it doesn't even exist.
We are...
Let's get through the rate thing first.
For, you're not gonna be able to get through the rate thing if you don't know what the head works is gonna be, correct?
That's correct.
That's not gonna happen in 2017, though.
18.
No, but what I'm getting at is you keep asking that, you're looking for more information, and now I'm asking you, when would you like this information?
Well, Weston and Sampson, that's the head works, which is pretty much a given.
But they've done all of our work, so they came up with a master plan with $32 million right there.
$32, thank you, John.
I'll give it to you.
Yeah, $32.
No, $32.
$32 was the big outside.
Yeah, but Carolyn added another $20 million into it.
Back to my question.
Yeah, I think as soon as you could get them to come in sometime, even toward the end of this month, would be great.
Okay.
And that, you know, we can, you know, do we have a particular date set for our...
Thursdays was the date of convenience for everybody.
Okay, Thursday.
Wasn't it? That's what we said in the first meeting?
Yes.
No.
No?
We have meetings on Thursday. I have a meeting this coming Thursday. Then I have a council of government meeting next Thursday.
All right, how about Tuesdays?
What chair meeting?
Never gonna be able to make, keep everybody happy.
No, I agree.
Get the majority in there.
We could do it, how about Saturday evenings in Newport, Rhode Island?
You're buying.
Show up.
If you're driving.
Hey, Henry, what's Saturday? I'm going.
Nobody's driving, we're staying over.
It's all being taped.
All right.
On the 22nd, Monday.
I can be most any night except for Wednesday nights. How about August 22nd?
What day is that?
Monday.
I can't make it, but go ahead.
I'm gone.
I got two gones and I can make it.
That's fine. 23rd?
Tuesdays.
I don't think I have a conflict on Thursday in August. All right, we have a hearing in September 15th, I think.
Well, how about the, all right, till 25th of August?
Which is?
Thursday.
I go to calendar.
It's a Thursday. Fourth Thursday of the month.
August 20 what?
Fifth.
25th.
I can make that one.
I can, for the record, I cannot.
Oh, you can.
But that's okay. You're never gonna get everybody.
I think I can on that one, sorry.
All right, then let's do that.
Next meeting, what are we gonna discuss? So you'll have to get we'll have to get something to John so we can get an agenda posted.
Well, can't somebody else just take my place on it?
Yeah.
I mean, I can do the agenda for the next meeting.
Right, and understood that we need to have an agenda.
But the next meeting, somebody's gonna have to do the agenda for the...
Before, because you're not gonna be...
That's fine.
But I think we still haven't set what we're gonna do with the 2017 rate.
We can talk about that.
That's still hanging out there.
We know we're gonna use the same methodology, but... we can talk about it.
Setting the sewer rate.
This is the agenda?
Sewer rate, period. That's similar to the...
There's 13 there.
We'll start at 6 o'clock, 6 o'clock, yep.
Yep.
We're on 8:25.
Do you want to have West End Sewer doing August?
August 25th, Thursday?
You think they have them going on the 25th?
That's what I'm...
At 6 p.m.?
You're going to text on it?
Sorry?
You text on it?
The agenda is the rate?
Right now, I'm going back and forth.
Agenda's the rate for the notice, Bruce?
Sewer rate, maybe the presentation by West End.
Do you need to turn it August 25th?
6 o'clock, yep.
Headworks presentation.
I'll get information from Lisa Needs' office in regard to what is allowable or permissible in terms of setting rate, whether they have to match an established budget.
Headworks and other discussion.
Yes.
Because if we can't collect more than we need to, then that saves us an article on that special town meeting.
Right. If there's such a big increase in the rate needed, that means we probably have been under-collecting?
Yeah.
Past few years?
No, we've been collecting less necessary.
How is, no?
Now we're looking for extra...
No, let me finish, John. How is that funded, through retained earnings?
Well, let me answer the first part. It's my understanding, based on those 3 years, that you've collected the revenue you set out to collect. So it's not like people didn't pay or you had a delinquency issue. I do have some clients that have that, but...
But we didn't pay.
What we collected was based on operational-only budget.
Right.
Based on...
Right.
There was no capital, allowed for capital or anything like that.
But now we're talking about 2017, we're at an increase.
Correct.
What is increased?
Well, first off, last year for FY16, our sewer line maintenance was cut in half. It went from,
Okay, sewer line maintenance with that.
It went from $48,000 to $24,000.
24.8, and you're asking for 75, potentially.
So, and that was one of the reasons why.
Okay.
And it's multiple, and again, it's just, you know, your 3% or 4.5% or whatever it was, because I don't have the numbers in front of me, of what your increases are and what the costs are. And that didn't include, you know, and these were just ballpark ideas on what we're trying, how we were going to go move forward with what we spent the last year. Because how I look at it is, I look at what I spent last year, figure out what's gone up, and then that's what I ask for money. And that's all I've asked for. I haven't asked for any capital or anything else, because all of these things were supposed to be coming through.
Is there an exhibit in here that shows the 624, what makes it up?
No.
Compared to what we actually spent the year before?
What we have is a 530...
We don't have an FY16 actually yet.
What we have in here is 15 and 16. I don't know. 17, 18, 16, I don't know.
Right, I understand we wouldn't have 16.
I have a number of 530,516.
Where did you get that?
Off of this.
Is it in here?
Out of the draft, yeah.
Now that was...
Deerfield budget, 35A.
35A? Then what shows, is there anything that lays the 624 next to the 2015?
No.
We can do that.
How did you get the 624?
It was the budget approved at town meeting this spring.
Yes.
Well, okay, then I would like to see the details of...
In the budget request that you go through town meeting, it should say last year proposed.
Oh, yeah.
I understand.
I can provide a table with it. We have that data.
I would like to see the details, why it went from 530 to 624.
The 530 detail?
No, I...
624, okay.
When was that?
We just got that as our...
What year was that? What year was that done, Jack?
Well, I understand, yeah.
We looked at total.
Well, you didn't just...
I know, I look at the town report, and it's got $600,000, and with no backup. But...
It's right there, $32 million.
And that's not the one I was taking issue with. It was a $52 million.
Well, that was the $20 million that Carol had.
This is something that was...
Can we have a motion to adjourn?
Please.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Can't say second quick enough.